Testosterone is probably the most discussed hormone in the fitness industry, largely due to its role in hypertrophy. Firstly, it's worth establishing some basic details. Under normal conditions, it's very broadly estimated around 70% of total testosterone is strongly bound to SHGB, that is, sex hormone binding globulin, 20 to 30% are weakly bound to albumin, and the remaining 1 to 2% is bound to nothing and called free testosterone. Testosterone strongly bound to SHGB cannot have an active effect on tissues. Testosterone bound to albumin, due to the binding being weak, can actively impact tissues. Free testosterone, of course, is freely capable of exerting effects too. When administered exogenously to evoke sustained elevations above normal levels, we know it can powerfully enhance hypertrophy adaptations in response to lifting weights. However, what about the somewhat inverse of this? Does lifting weights increase testosterone? In a previous video, we saw that lifting weights can temporarily spike testosterone concentrations, but in this particular video, we'll be focusing on if lifting weights can chronically increase your resting testosterone levels. This seems like a straightforward question, yet, closer inspection would reveal an array of factors worth considering. Are we talking previously untrained or trained individuals? Young or older individuals? What are the baseline testosterone levels of the person in question? What were the training variables and exercises used? Finally, are we talking about total testosterone, free testosterone, or bioavailable testosterone? Note, bioavailable testosterone refers to both albumin-bound and free testosterone. Accordingly, as we dissect the current existing literature, we'll do our best to ensure these factors are considered. Let's dive in. Firstly, a recent 2021 meta-analysis by Potter and colleagues combined findings of 9 randomized controlled trials, all conducted on previously unresistance trained men ranging from 18 to 75 years old. The normal total testosterone range for men roughly lies between 270 nanograms per deciliter to 1070 nanograms per deciliter, and the subjects' average levels in these 9 studies fell within this range. Most studies had subjects perform 2 to 3 full body workouts a week, with mainly compound exercises comprising the program, with movements like the leg press, bench press, and lat pull down commonly used. Largely 6 to 12 weekly sets were performed for the trained muscle groups, with repetitions performed 2 or very close to failure with loads between 50% and 80% or 1 rep max. On screen are the approximate results, indicating lifting weights had no significant effect on resting total testosterone concentrations. A 2018 meta-analysis by Hayes and Elliott further supports this conclusion. With older men, 17 randomized and unrandomized controlled trials conducted on previously unresistant trained men at or above the age of 60, with a large majority of subjects still within the normal total, bioavailable, or free testosterone ranges, were combined. Like before, most studies included 2 to 3 full body workouts per week, with mainly compound exercises comprising the program, with movements like the leg press, bench press, and lat pull down commonly used. Largely 6 to 12 weekly sets were performed for the trained muscle groups, with repetitions performed 2 or very close to failure with loads between 50% and 80% or 1 rep max. On screen are the findings, indicating lifting weights did not have a significant effect on free, bioavailable, or total testosterone resting concentrations. So, 2 meta-analyses indicate in men of varying ages, lifting weights does not impact resting testosterone concentrations. However, it's worth reiterating all of this data was derived from previously untrained men who were largely within the normal testosterone ranges. What about trained men, or men with low total testosterone concentrations, roughly defined as below 270 nanograms per deciliter? Could lifting weights impact resting concentrations in either of these demographics? Exploring the low testosterone demographic first, 3 comparable randomized trials out of Denmark recruited men between 60 to 78 years old. With low bioavailable testosterone concentrations, their average levels were around 129 nanograms per deciliter, and a waist circumference greater than 94 centimeters. These studies set out to examine the effects of exogenous testosterone treatment in the form of gel, with resistance training. However, there were groups that only resistance trained with a placebo gel. Subjects trained 2 to 3 times per week for 10 weeks. They trained leg presses, knee extensions, leg curls, chest presses, lat pulldowns, back extensions, and crunches for 2 to 3 sets with reps very likely to or close to failure with 6 to 10 rep max loads. In all three studies, the placebo group that resistance trained did not experience increases in bioavailable testosterone, indicating even in older men with low testosterone levels, lifting weights may have no effect on resting testosterone concentrations. As for trained individuals, a couple of studies provide insight. Schwanbeck and colleagues had 15 men with an average of around 2.5 years of training experience perform a free weight or machine-only program. The respective group's programs are on screen. Each exercise was trained for 3 to 4 sets of 4 to 10 reps. This study assessed free testosterone, with baseline measures being in the normal range. After the training period, neither group experienced any changes in resting concentrations. Mangine and colleagues had 33 men with 2 years of average training experience perform a range of exercises. One group trained each exercise for 4 sets of 3 to 5 reps with 90% or 1 rep max loads, while another group used 4 sets of 10 to 12 reps with 70% or 1 rep max loads. Subjects were within the normal total testosterone ranges. After the study, neither group experienced any changes in resting total testosterone concentrations. McCall and colleagues recruited men with prior training experience, no further details were given, who were within the normal total testosterone ranges. They trained 4 biceps exercises and 4 other exercises, again no further details were given, for 3 sets with a 10 rep max load. After 12 training weeks, resting total testosterone concentrations were unchanged. Finally, Ostrowski and colleagues had 35 men with 1 to 4 years of training experience train a range of exercises for sets of 7 to 12 repetitions to failure. Some subjects trained each exercise for 1 set, the low volume group, some 2 sets per exercise, the moderate volume group, and the rest used 4 sets per exercise, the high volume group. Neither group experienced statistically significant changes in total testosterone resting concentrations as a result of training. I should note the data of this study was kind of all over the place, as you can see with the numbers provided. The data was highly variable, as indicated by the standard deviations, making it difficult to decipher anything. So, all of the data assessed so far indicates lifting weights has no impact on resting testosterone concentrations. Yet, I'm aware of 2 studies contrasting with this. Izquierdo and colleagues had Spanish national team basketball players with resistance training experience, and within the normal total testosterone ranges, train the parallel squat and bench press twice per week for 11 weeks. Subjects were either allocated to a failure or non-failure group. During the first 6 weeks, the failure group trained each exercise with 3 sets of reps to failure with a 10 rep max load, while the non-failure group used 6 sets of 5 reps with a 10 rep max load. Throughout this period, neither group experienced changes in resting total testosterone concentrations. During the next 5 weeks, the failure group trained each movement with 3 sets of reps to failure with a 6 rep max load, while the non-failure group used 6 sets of 3 reps with a 6 rep max load. Throughout this period, the failure group's resting total testosterone concentrations remained unchanged, but the non-failure group's resting total testosterone concentrations were increased. Thus, perhaps compound exercises with heavy loads, but only performing a few repetitions, alters total testosterone resting concentrations. However, it's difficult to verify this claim as there is no similar studies as far as I know. The closest paper was the previously mentioned Mangine and colleague study, which found in one group of subjects training a range of compound exercises for 3 to 5 reps with 90% or 1 rep max loads, resting total testosterone concentrations remain unaltered. Still, differences between these 2 studies, such as the precise training variables and participants, exist. As for the second study, Kramer and colleagues had 8 young men with an average age of 30, and 9 older men with an average age of 62, within the normal testosterone ranges, train a range of exercises with the loads used varying across the 3 training days per week. Throughout 10 weeks of training, neither the young nor older men experienced increases in resting total testosterone concentrations, but the young men did experience increases in resting free testosterone concentrations. This was not the case for the older men. Despite this finding, a comparably designed study by Petrella and colleagues conflicts. 13 young men between 20 and 35 and 13 older men between 60 and 75 trained the leg extension, leg press, and squat each for 3 sets of 8 to 12 repetitions, 3 times per week for 16 weeks. Neither the young nor older men experienced an increase in resting total or free testosterone concentrations. Though, it's still worth noting exercise selection did differ between this study and the one by Kramer, so it's not clear if this may explain the divergent outcomes. In summary, the majority of evidence indicates in a wide range of individuals, lifting weights does not appear to increase resting total, free, or bioavailable testosterone concentrations. Yet, it's worth considering this data does not necessarily prove lifting weights never increases resting testosterone concentrations. It remains plausible that training variables could matter. Virtually all of the data we assessed had subjects train with full body splits, but what about something like bro splits? Moreover, minimal data explore the effects of training with loads above 80% or 1 rep max, as well as different proximities from failure. Finally, virtually all of the data assessed lasted 12 weeks or less. What about many months or even years? For example, Hakkinen and colleagues found after following up on elite weightlifters for 2 years, their resting total testosterone concentrations had elevated. However, there are two problems with this data. Firstly, they were weightlifters, and as such would have been regularly training Olympic lifts, which is not what most recreational or competitive individuals after muscle hypertrophy or typical strength gains would do. It's not clear how this would influence things. Secondly, although the researchers stated they were not taking anabolic steroids before or during the 2 years, I'm a little skeptical of this as they were established champions or record holders in Finland, with impressive numbers. That brings us to the end of the video. As always, thank you for watching. I hope you found the video interesting and informative in some way.